consumers who need to be protected. Therefore, consider all this, and from that point of view, I would really like you to come up with what your feelings are in regard to whether we need regulator, and if so, the experience in the past, how far it has been good or bad. I would like persons in various, like for example, let's start with education, health, telecom, power, any one of the fields, of, the response from the audience.
Comment or raise a question, Mr. Vaidyanathan or to others. This is the time, this is the opportunity. Maybe I can start by simply making one comment, and that is I agree with Mr. Vaidyanathan as far as the elected regulatory bodies are concerned, which is whether it's the Bar Council of India, whether it is the Medical Council, the Institute of Chartered Accountants, and the Cost and Works Accountants. I agree with him that in the function of regulatory or regulating the bodies and disciplinary aspects of regulating that, there have been failures to the extent that the consumer that has to be eventually protected is not protected by them. So the result has been the need for the consumer courts, which have since now been put in place, and that's where you get your relief. You don't get it if you send in a complaint, by and large, to any of these counts, elected bodies, even their disciplinary committees, you never hardly ever get satisfactory responses and justice. As to the other one, I think Mr. Vaidyanathan touched this aspect that in the end, it is the consumer that needs to be protected from exploitation, particularly when you're bringing in too many players into the same field of activity, which is basically commercial. In the end, there is a service that's provided to the consumer. Question then is, how do you, I can understand a monopolies commission protecting a consumer against somebody. But on the other, is there a need for something like the telecom authority or not? Because of what it does in one of its functions, as far as I understand it, is to fix or approve the rates at which they can be charged. And they take the competition aspect into account in doing that. So I'm not so, I'm a little unsure whether a free market would actually protect them in the same way, or because within the free market also, we are aware of groups of suppliers of services ganging up in a way which, what do they call them? Cartels, leading to exploitation. So, I mean, that doubt remains with me. But now the it's open. Basically, this was meant for questions to the panel. So, from the floor, and they are now invited. Please, we hope you
may respond in regard to the telecom, for example, the rate setting. In fact, today, we don't have rate setting. We had, first when the industry was opened up, the invitation for tender said that the rate will be 16.80 rupees per minute for a cellular telephone. Government wanted to raise revenues, and they said that we are going to allow you to charge the 16.80 rupees per minute. And they, people quoted very high license fees. What happened? Between 94 and 99, the total number of cellular subscribers was 3 lakhs in 1999, after the industry opened up in 1994. When this was done away with in 1999, fixed license fee regime was scrapped, and you had a revenue sharing. You saw the consumer shoot up. Then you had, when the industry was opened up and more competitors came in, the rates came down from 3 rupees per minute to today what it is, sometimes it is 30 paise per minute. Now, how did this happen? When you do away with monopolies or duopolies or oligopolies, but have free competition, this is what happens. You don't then need setting up rates.
Nagarajan, a comment from you, please.
think there are two divergent points of view that seem to have emerged from both the learned speakers. I would look at it like this, that certain amount of regulation, I think, is a healthy regulation. What would happen is, I can again give you an example from the power sector. There are most of the natural resources are all belonging to the government in the hydroelectric generation. That is the cheapest and the best form of power. Now, how the state should utilize this natural resource is one aspect. Now, under the powers given in the Act, a matter of policy is still left to the government. The government can lay down a policy which is binding on the electricity regulator. So the regulator is really not allowed to make a policy of its own. It will have to ensure that the players in the field operate within the four corners of the policy. If the policy is found to be obnoxious or illegal or unconstitutional, that can certainly be challenged in Article 226 by recourse to the constitutional courts. But so long as the ground rules are made and framed by the government, and if that policy is not something which is not in the interests of the whole system, then the regulator has to work in accordance with it. Now, what happens is that if you allow free market to operate, then there are some resources. Again, giving you an example. Now, all the transmission lines belong to the state. In the past, they were all owned by the state electricity boards, and subsequently, they're owned by new companies set up by them, the transmission companies. Now, supposing the regulator is not there, if I put up a generating plant in Mysore and I want to take my power to Dharwad, the transmission company may say, sorry, if you give me a huge amount of money only, I will allow you, otherwise I will not allow you. Then who is there to regulate? Because the company which owns the resources is government. The private individual has come and set it up, and he is not able to transmit the power. And another factor is, you see, setting up a power plant involves tying up a number of things. One of them is the transmission. If they don't have a guaranteed right to transmit power, therefore the regulator stepped in and made what is called as the open access regulations. And it said that if these rules are followed, it is open for anybody to come and utilize the natural resources or the created resource which belongs to the state. So I think till our economy matures to such an extent that absolute rules of fair play with no regulation at all could be operated, because in many foreign countries, Western countries, especially in UK, the entire grid system is not owned by the government. There are private companies which are listed on the stock exchanges and others who are in the sector of providing infrastructure to certain category of industries. So then what will happen is the creation of infrastructure itself has become free, and therefore there is free competition possible. Now, in our country, I think it will take some time. We have started in that direction so far as highways are concerned. Now, there is a certain element of privatization of highways. We are at a stage of regulating that process now, what kind of tariff should be made, in what kind of national level should be made. So I think at this juncture in our economy, I think it is necessary to have a bit of regulation. And another comment on what Mr. Venugopal was mentioning was about the persons who are going to be appointed. Many of these statutes contain a provision that once appointed to the commission, as soon as their tenure is over, it's always a fixed tenure, it's 3 years or 5 years. Once the tenure is over, whatever be your age, of course there's an age cap, if you have not crossed it and you completed your 5 years, you cannot continue in the commission. You cannot go back or revert back to your parent department. You will not be able to be employed by the government. These three are complete bar in the Act itself. But only one aspect is that if a private sector takes you on as a consultant, what is wrong with it, I would say? Supposing a retired secretary to government in the power sector, after he retires as the principal secretary. Next day, a power company says, you've been serving as power secretary so many years, we want you. Of course, there are two ways of looking at it. One is he's going to use his past influence to lobby things around. That is one aspect. But then you can't really curtail somebody's right to give a consultation so long as it is not an abuse of the process. Because I know many of these former bureaucrats who are identified by leading industrialists in that sector, and they're taken on honestly and genuinely to guide them and advise them, because there are so many nuances. So I think
this is one aspect, the same problem we have of this with judges also. Post-retirement, what could they do? What could they not do? I mean, so these are issues of, again, I would say, something to do with the person who dons that mantle. Those are my comments.
I'd like to respond to two of the aspects. One is about these retired people, and second about the regulation for transmission. I think what Mr. Krishnamanagopal meant was in respect of a retired regulator, not a retired bureaucrat. And he was in particular referring to a retired chairman of the TRAI, who as a regulator is regulating, as you were saying, competing industries in the telecom field. And if he on retirement goes and joins one of the telecom operators, surely his independence is suspect.
What happened was that this was a project involving several thousand crores. It was a road project. The entire project envisaged that some amount of land would be given to somebody. The gentleman who was holding the post as Secretary PWD, who was responsible for doing all of these things, actually joined this project developer. And he knew exactly what was happening in government, what records were to be created, how it was created, where what file is available. And he is the chief executive who went on doing everything. In fact, all the files of the government were with him even after he retired. So this is really a problem. But I think the answer should be to the, if supposing a former bureaucrat is appointed as a regulator, there is a committee that has to go into it. It's, and one more clarification is, usually it is with the concurrence and the consultation of the Chief Justice. There is an appointment process. The Chief Justice of India in the case of appellate authorities, the State Chief Justice in the case of the regulatory authorities. Of course, how effective that consultation process should be is a matter for the Chief Justice to decide. But there is an independent three-member panel which goes into it. There's a formal record of proceedings are made, details are given, views of the Chief Justice are taken into consideration, and the committee appoints. Of course, finally, the ball rests with the state. The appointing authority is the state. But once appointed, you can do nothing about it. So it's a sense of independent bearing. And my own experience shows that many of the regulatory bodies are really functioning independently, because I've seen many of them pulling up government and really taking them to task to say, you have fixed a tariff like this. Come on, please tell us how you fixed it. What are the basis? I want to see the government files. Let us see what is there in it. How did you arrive at this? And many times, though I appear for government most of the times, we have no answer for this. And when we tell the client, well, if you have no answer, this is a fixation is going to go, they just throw up their hands and say, sir, what to do? That minister at that time did it. So the regulatory bodies have actually struck down those decisions and said, no, we don't approve this. You will have to pay a lower rate than what the government approved. Such orders have been made and upheld by appellate authorities and courts also. So I think,
on the second aspect which you are mentioning about this interconnection, transmission, etc., these are really, again, it's not a matter of regulation. It is an interesting commercial dispute between two entities which is to be resolved by an adjudicatory body like tribunal. I am today focusing more on the regulator. The dispute resolution tribunals in different sectors are a different aspect completely. And even in regard to appointment, what Ms. Naganand mentioned about consultation with the Chief Justice takes place in regard to appellate tribunals. In regard to appointment of TRI chairman, CERC chairman, no such consultation with the Chief Justice is involved, because they are not adjudicatory bodies in that sense. Therefore, no consultation is required with the Chief Justice of India or with the Chief Justice of the High Court for this. But for appellate bodies, consultation is needed.
See, I'd just like to bring a slightly theoretical perspective again into the whole issue. If you look at electricity regulation, or earlier, until technology disrupted telecom regulation, the problem in strictly economic terms is one of natural monopolies. You need infrastructure to be laid in order to get telephone calls to the person who you're calling. You need transmission lines in order to make sure that electricity gets from point A to point B when you're traveling long distances. To have two transmission lines or four transmission lines over the same distance would be economically wasteful. So therefore, you have a single transmission line, provided it is of sufficient capacity. And the problem, I think, that Mr. Naganand is pointing out is a real one, that in the context of dismantling or unbundling of state electricity boards, the government believed that if you had, for example, a separate state generation company, a separate transmission company, a separate distribution company, and trading companies, the influence of the incumbent state electricity board would be reduced sufficiently that each entity that is unbundled would go ahead and make decisions based on market forces, i.e. based on price. Therefore, you could have private competitors coming in each unbundled segment, and the other entities in the outside that segment would be willing to deal with it. Now, when I talked about independence, etc., and the revolving door between state monopolies and the regulator, the problem that arises is that even among the unbundled entities, it is the state government in the electricity department which will, or the power ministry, which will decide who staffs each of these entities. And each of these people are capable of picking up the phone and talking to each other, so the state generating company is likely, I'm saying there's a possibility, I'm just talking theoretically, the state generating company head will pick up the phone and talk to the transmission company and say, look, my electricity price, because the state government is making me do all these economically wasteful things, I cannot go down below, let us say, 5 rupees a unit in such and such place. So don't allow this significantly cheaper private generating company to come in and compete with me in that area, so don't give him your transmission line. Now, if they are all related in the sense of having been appointed by the state government and still working in tandem, either through the state power secretary or otherwise, there's a strong possibility that the transmission company owned by the state company will tell the private company, look, if you want me to carry your electricity, I'm going to charge you 6 rupees a unit, so that you become uncompetitive with the state generating company. And it is to avoid these situations that in natural monopolies you frequently have the regulator coming in. At the same time, I would agree with Mr. Vaidyanathan that where technology permits you to completely do away with natural monopolies, like, for example, cellular technology in the case of telephones, then you can have multiple companies, multiple participants, multiple players in the sphere of telephones, so that market-based competition will automatically bring down pricing. And we come then to the next level of the problem. When you have some companies who are early entrants, like I don't want to name the big names in the telecom sector. I believe Mr. Vaidyanathan has represented all of them. So when you have some big names in the telecom sector who are headed by people who become billionaires, from maybe crorepatis, they become dollar billionaires. There is a case for government, for example, bringing in more competition. The problem is if government steps in by bringing in competition in the manner that they did in 2G, you can take a very successful sector that is well regulated with what they call light touch regulation, such as TRAI, suddenly being thrown into chaos, and the entire sector goes down in public esteem, goes down in terms of perceived investor friendliness, et cetera, as has happened in the telecom sphere. So there you can make out a case that if TRAI had been given all the functions, including the licensing function and the spectrum selling function, it may have been better for competition than leaving it in the hands of the minister. But all this depends, I think, on the facts and circumstances of the case.
Yes, Mr. Vaidyanathan, my name is Eric Kreya. I'm an advocate from Goa. You started the session by posing a question, do we need regulators? Now, if we see today, with the opening of the economy, like taking the in housing or in the insurance sector, the opening of the economy has led to cartelization. That means in order to safeguard the consumer, don't you think that we need regulation? Like an example is I would give of the Competition Commission of India. Well, it in the housing sector, it helped with regard to the DLF case, if you remember, because they had put in clauses in the agreement which were totally against home buyers. And they stepped in and they said that it was not correct what DLF was doing. Same way in the insurance sector also, we have seen how many of these, there are so many players in the market. But the, don't you think that we need some form of regulatory authority to safeguard the end consumer? I'm not talking of the players per se, but in order to safeguard the end consumer, some sort of regulation would be necessary.
See, that's why I think, you know, we have to differentiate between a dispute resolution machinery and a regulatory mechanism. Yes, Competition Commission, when it resolves these disputes, these kind of disputes, it has an adjudicatory role. It has a policy making, it has a regulatory, it has an adjudicatory function. To what extent do we need regulators? That, I believe, is the principal subject. Dispute resolution mechanism, certainly we need. I have no doubt about it. But do we need regulation in that sense? And if so, I mean, what is it? Therefore, to the extent of standard setting or laying down certain guidelines in regard to this, yes, maybe. But we don't need a continuing regulator. That's a one-time exercise, and that somebody would do. But we need a continuing functionary for dispute resolution. That's a different thing.
This is law school. Sir, I paid attention, so I know I'm a student, so I might be wrong in asking this question. But I totally agreed with the point of Sir Vidyanathan about, you know, we don't need a regulatory body. And I even like the question of Sir Shankar Das that what if cartels are formed? So can we not keep it restricted in case of oligopoly, as of what I've studied till now? Cartels are usually seen in case of oligopolies. So can we not restrict these regulatory bodies to oligopoly markets and leave it open for the rest? Decisions will be faster that way, probably.
I was actually raising my question in a similar way for Mr. Vedanathan. And I think he's done a very good job of trying to answer it anyway. Is there anyone else? Because we are now running short of time. And yes, sir.
I'm Pratap from Hyderabad.
Sorry?
Pratap from Hyderabad.
Yep.
To some extent, Mr. Vaidyanathan is correct. Whether this system of regulatory system is really required or a tribunal should have an extended one before any dispute.